Well, good evening. I think I'm going to go ahead and get started here. It's a pretty packed agenda tonight, and I'd like to stay as much on time as we can since we've got everybody coming in here in the evening. So thank you very much for coming this evening. My name is Ken Smith. I'm the director of the Mobility Division at the Stanford Center on Longevity, and I would love to welcome you to the kickoff event for our second design challenge, enabling personal mobility across the lifespan. Just a bit of housekeeping here. There are restrooms out just across the lobby. We're going to have the catering up afterwards too, so if you didn't get an hors d'oeuvre or a drink on the way in, there will be an opportunity on the way out. If you are choosing to tweet this, live tweet during the event, please go ahead and use the hashtag MoveDesign, and we're collecting things on Twitter under that hashtag. So I just wanted to start off by saying a few words about the Stanford Center on Longevity. For those of you who have not had a chance to get to know us yet, we are an interdisciplinary and multidisciplinary research center at Stanford University. We were founded in 2006. Our director is Dr. Laura Carstensen, who you'll hear from later on this evening. Our deputy director is Dr. Tom Rando, who is a neurologist and a stem cell biologist, who will not be here this evening. Really, the intellectual horsepower for the Center on Longevity comes from our faculty affiliate network. We have, it says 140 plus, we're just about at 150 faculty across the university who have looked at our mission and agreed with it and agreed to be involved in any way they can when we can find ways to bring their research to bear. So the Center on Longevity is really looking to redesign long life. It's a very ambitious and a very broad thing to do, but we believe that, you know, aging is really one of the mega trends of your lifetime, one of our lifetimes. And so what we look to do is, and I'll talk about this a little bit more, but what we look to do is to change culture to catch up with the rates of our aging society. And we do this under a tagline that Dr. Carstensen mentioned in her book, A Long Bright Future. To the extent that people arrive at old age mentally sharp, physically fit, and financially secure, individuals and societies will thrive. So under that, we're organized with three divisions. We have a mind division that looks at issues around cognition, memory, those sort of things. A mobility division, which I mentioned I direct, and I'll talk a little bit more about what we mean by mobility in just a second. And we also have a financial security division, looking at the way that planning for retirement has changed, looking at the decision to retire. You know, should people still be retiring at 65 in a world where they are now living to much, much older ages? And we also look at prevention of financial fraud against the elderly. So our program for tonight looks like this. I'm going to do a little bit of a kickoff and kind of give you the general sense of the why we're doing this challenge and what the challenge is going to be. I'm going to hand this off then to Stephen Johnston from Aging 2.0. Oh, Katie, are you going to do this? Oh, and Katie Fike, the co-founders of Aging 2.0, who have been our collaborators on the design challenge from almost day one. And then we'll have a couple of great talks for you. And there's a little bit of a program change this evening from what you see written down. Originally on your programs, it says that Shelley Fole, who's the director of the executive director of the President's Council on Fitness, Sports, and Nutrition, was going to be speaking. Unfortunately, she was sick this morning and did not get on a plane coming from Washington. Dr. Laura Carstensen, our director, has graciously agreed to speak, and actually I've seen heard some of her materials, and I think it's going to be very applicable, and I think it'll be a great talk. And happy to have you, and thank you, Laura, for stepping in. Then Dr. Leila Takayama will be representing the World Economic Forum's Global Agenda Council on Robotics and Artificial Intelligence, and we'll talk a little bit more about the design side of things. And then we're going to finish up with something I'm excited to see. We've just tried it for the first time this year, but it's the results of something that happened a week ago where, and Lauren Grieco, who works at the center, will also tell you a little bit more about this, but basically a number of older people have been given the lens of design thinking to look through, and then they've been out for a week or two and kind of viewing their world through that lens of design thinking, and we're going to get them back together and talk about that tonight and have a panel discussion from them. And then we'll wrap up and have a little bit of networking out in the lobby and outside. So I'm going to start, as I said, talking about why we choose to do a design challenge like this and what the challenge is going to look like. And apologies for the slides. That actually seemed to work on my computer, so I think it must be translating PC to Mac. Normally at this point, I would start out with a number of histograms and pictures of how the world is aging and the fact that many more people are having the opportunity to reach old age than ever before. And so we are seeing distributions of age in our society that are really unlike anything that we've seen before, really, in human history. But I think most of the people that come to this probably have a little bit of a sense of that, so I'm cutting to the chase a little bit tonight in the interest of time, and really saying that, you know, aging is one of the mega trends of our time. And so understanding it and being prepared for it is really critical, not just for people who are themselves older, but for people of all ages. And aging has happened very, very quickly. In developed countries, the average lifespan at birth has doubled since 1900. So people now, you know, living to an average of 82, 84, depending on whether you're talking about men or women. And our culture has really not kept up. The institutions of our society, education, social support networks, retirement ages, really have not had time to catch up to this, you know, huge achievement of people living longer. That's happened really, you know, as Laura often says, in the blink of an eye. And so we felt that with this design challenge, we could provide a couple of things. Obviously, we can get through the university students and young designers, fresh eyes, new solutions, the kind of things that you might expect out of a design challenge. But even more than that, and probably our bigger goal, is educating a whole new generation in aging opportunities. Because when young designers are told to design for what they know, and when they think about what they want to design for, it's not always obvious that the first thing that comes to mind is, I'm going to be designing something for older people. But when you get them engaged and when you get them to know a little bit about the topic, it's one that's very personal, because, you know, everybody has parents, everybody has grandparents, and they begin to come to these design ideas a little bit more organically once you get them going. And what we found out in doing this over the last 2 years, really, is that there's a bigger resonant topic in general, and that's getting people of all ages working on issues and opportunities for aging people and for older people. And again, it's resonated, and you'll start to see that as we talk about some of the sponsors that have come on board and some of the things that we're doing, that beyond just designing products or designing things, it's really this bigger area that has become really exciting. And finally, you know, being Stanford, we would like to take this beyond just the design itself, but also, can we provide a ramp to seeing these products and these ideas find their way out and actually help people? So we really look to find, you know, a path for people after the design challenge, not just, you know, presenting a prize at the end. So why mobility? I wanted to talk a little about how we think about mobility at the Center on Longevity. And it's hard to do that without talking about a concept called compression and morbidity. Who in the audience is familiar with that term? Okay, so a few, but probably worth going through here. So if we look at a graph of age versus quality of life, and I'm smiling at Laura because you have a slide that says almost anything relative to age, typically looks like that, and historically has looked like that. So, you know, generally there's a high quality of life throughout most of youth and middle age, maybe rolls off a little as you get a little older, and then there's this drop off with age. Now, back in 1980, there was a professor at Stanford, Jim Fries, who's actually a affiliate of the Center on Longevity, that proposed the idea that what we wanted was something like this, where quality of life remains very high, right out to very close to the end of life, and then drops off very quickly. And that's known as compression and morbidity. And if you notice, the end point there doesn't actually move a whole lot. I mean, certainly life extension is great, but really what we're more concerned with is the quality of life, you know, over the full lifespan. So you're going to hear us, and actually I'm going to go back here. So we look at this in a couple of different ways. You know, you can preserve this quality of life by prevention. You can talk about how you can get people to exercise more, to eat better, to keep them up on that line. You can talk about ways that when mobility restrictions start to occur, because I would maintain that mobility is a pretty good proxy for quality of life. I mean, the ability to get around by yourself in the world, not have to necessarily depend on others, is a pretty good proxy there. And I think, you can also find ways where, as mobility issues start to crop up, you've seen lots of developments in the medical field. I mean, artificial joints, lots of, you know, those sort of things that are actually more what I would call interventions rather than prevention. And then out here, when you incur mobility issues that can't necessarily be fixed, we talk about accommodation or changing the world around you in a way that allows quality of life to remain high even with mobility issues. And so you're going to see that reflected, you know, in the design challenge. Now, I wanted to talk specifically about physical activity because it comes up again and again. And this is a list that I came across that's actually in the Federal Guidelines for Physical Activity from 2008. So it reads like something that, you know, someone with a supplement that was trying to, you know, sell the cure-all would be, right? And, you know, this is from the government. And so you can see the number of things that are affected by physical activity. And it's the things that you would expect, like cardiovascular disease. But also you start to see, you know, lower risks of cancer, prevention of falls. It's good for depression. And then even last year when we had our finals, which were around cognitive issues, Frank Longo, who's a doctor at Stanford and one of the leading experts on Alzheimer's, actually made a statement that stuck with me. And he said, we've got one drug that's actually been scientifically validated to be correlated to a reduction in Alzheimer's. It's free, everybody can get at it, and no one will take it. And it's exercise. So there's the but, is that I don't think if I took a poll of this audience that there would be lots of people that would try to argue against the benefits of exercise. But as a society, our numbers are not getting better. The percentage of people who are getting no exercise or very little exercise have not only not gotten better, they've gotten worse in terms of purely sedentary behavior. A recent study came out looking at the National Health and Nutrition Survey data, and the thing that jumped out was really that the number of people reporting no physical activity during leisure time actually significantly increased from the 1990 timeframe to around 2010. So we're going the wrong direction, and we need to find some solutions to this. One indication of how important this is and that we're hitting on a topic that people actually care about is that one of our key collaborators on this is the President's Council on Physical Fitness, Sports, and Nutrition. We've recently signed a memorandum of understanding between the Center on Longevity and the President's Council to help them expand their agenda. They are really looking to help Americans of all ages, but most of their programming has been for kids in, you know, K through 12. I think everybody knows about the Presidential Physical Fitness Challenge, and we kid about doing push-ups since the Eisenhower administration. That's these guys. And they're looking to really expand their agenda to include older Americans, and we're looking to help them do that. As I mentioned, Shelley Fole, their executive director, was originally planning on speaking tonight, and she sends her regrets that she couldn't make it, and we hope to have her out here in the future. So with that background, this is the challenge this year. It's enabling personal mobility across the lifespan, and what we are looking for are solutions to reduce those sedentary lifestyles that we talked about, to encourage and enable physical movement and exercise, and to break down the barriers in the home and the community that might prevent that. And once again, this is a challenge that's open to the entire world. Any university in the world can enter. We have $10,000 for first prize, $5,000 for second, $2,000 for third. We will be selecting finalists in January, and Stephen and Katie are going to talk a little about this this timeline in a minute here. But we'll select finalists in January, and we'll actually bring those finalists physically here to Stanford to present in front of companies and investors and academics, and, you know, give them a chance to really get to know the people that can actually help their designs find their way out into the world. I mentioned that we did this last year. That last year was our first year of the challenge, and our topic was maximizing independence for those with cognitive impairment. Interestingly enough, there was numbers in there previously, but we had 52 entries last year representing 31 universities in 15 different countries. So we were actually really happy with the scope that we were able to achieve geographically. And even beyond that, we were happy with the scope of what we were able to see in those solutions that came in. So these were the first, second, and third place winners from last year. First place was Xiao Yao from the Academy of Art Institute in San Francisco that reimagined what a place setting would look like for people with Alzheimer's disease. Beautiful job of user-centered design. And in fact, Sha, I'm looking for here is here somewhere. Oh, there she is. And so we're happy to see you come back this year. What's that?
She can't win twice.
She cannot win. Well, she could win twice. Well, actually, she's not a student anymore, so no. Sorry, you're too old already. And I think if any of you wants to hear the story of, you know, that it's not easy to necessarily get from idea to product, I think Sha can meet with you over a drink later. But as an indication of kind of the breadth of what we saw from a discipline perspective, second place was actually this group from the National University of Singapore that produced a spoon that has a battery in it and electrodes on the bottom that actually electrically stimulates taste buds to increase the taste in people who may experience diminishing taste with dementia or cognitive impairment. And then third place was this team from the Copenhagen Institute of Interactive Design that had a solution for really mapping memories for people with very early stage cognitive impairment to capture those memories and to put them together in a way that could help them as they experienced, you know, further impairment and also keep them in a way that their family could cherish as well. So that's all I'm going to say. As I mentioned, the folks from Aging 2 are going to talk a little about the details, but I do definitely have to take a few minutes here to talk about our sponsors. You can imagine running a worldwide challenge like this, bringing people from all over the world, we could not do by ourselves. And so I want to recognize a few people here, and happily this list is getting longer, so it may take me a couple of minutes, but it's a happy thing to do. So I first want to recognize Russ Hill and the New Retirement Forum. Russ couldn't be here tonight, but Russ and the New Retirement Forum was really our founding sponsor for the challenge, and so I always want to go back and thank him. And he again is part of the sponsorship this year. We are happy to have the Davis Finney Foundation this year. And in fact, we have some representation here, so thank you very much. No one is here from AARP, but I'm happy to announce AARP as a sponsor of the challenge as well. Jody Holtzman, who's the Director of Technology and Innovation, has been our key contact there, and we're really happy to have them on board. This one I'm very excited about. Target is now part of the challenge as well. And what I'm really excited about here beyond just the sponsorship is the recognition of products for aging being products for everybody. I mean, Target is about as dead center a retailer as you can imagine. And so having them on board is really a recognition that these issues are becoming mainstream and that the products that we're talking about are really looking to be mainstream products. Home Care Assistance, who was one of our sponsors last year, and I think we should have some people from Home Care Assistance here. There you are. Thank you for coming, and thank you for sponsoring again this year. They've been a great source of knowledge about what happens in the home. I mean, they're hands-on with a lot of people at home every day. We have Tideswell at UCSF, which formerly was the program for the Aging Century, and I don't know that we have anyone here this evening. We don't, but we thank them. We'd also like to thank our technology and marketing partners. Skilled is the platform that we run the challenge on, and they've definitely been helpful along the way. The International Council on Active Aging is going to help us promote the challenge worldwide. HTech West is again here as a sponsor and as a source of information about technology and how the technology is being used in the aging services industry. And I'm really happy to announce our very first device sponsor, Tile Wellness, and Philo and Company is here somewhere. If you haven't seen them, they're actually set up with a demo of their product out in the small room next door. And what they have, you'll see, is a force measurement device that allows kind of isometric exercise to be built into games and things like that. And what they've offered is they're actually providing 10 of their devices to teams that might want to use them. And what we really want to recognize here is that in this fitness space, in this exercise space, there's been this huge growth in the ability to measure things. And we want our designers to think they don't have to start at ground zero. There are all these tools and platforms that they can work from. And what we'll be judging, of course, is the originality that they bring to things. But we're happy to have somebody here who can actually provide them a device and maybe get some imaginative minds working on some new applications. Last and certainly not least, I want to recognize the Center on Longevity's corporate affiliates who are sponsors with us in a much broader way and work with us on all of the things we do. And I know Andy from caring.com is here tonight, and I want to thank them for their sponsorship. I don't know that we have anyone from any of our other affiliates here this evening. So one last special announcement for Stanford students, who I think we have a few in the audience. Since we're talking about mobility, this is a very special flavor of mobility, but Dave Jaffe, Dave is here, runs a winter quarter class on perspectives in assistive technology where he pairs design students with folks from the disabled community, and they together work on solutions, and it's a great class, and I encourage any Stanford students who might be interested to grab Dave outside. Thank you. And so with that, I'm going to turn it over to Katie and Stephen. I may have gone a hair long here, but we'll get you queued up here. Thank you.
I think we're going to be good.
Great. Well, thank you so much. And it's been such a pleasure to collaborate with Stanford at both last year and this year. And Stephen and I are the co-founders of Aging 2.0. And I just want to tell you a little bit about Aging 2.0 and why we're excited about this challenge. So Aging 2.0 is a global innovation platform. Our goal is to connect, educate, and support innovators who want to work in aging and long-term care. And a lot of the points that Ken mentioned, I think, really tap into our ethos, which is we really believe that it's going to take interdisciplinary, it's going to take intergenerational, and it's going to take international collaboration to really bring the smartest people together and focused on these challenges and opportunities of our aging society and a culture that needs to catch up. So the role that Aging 2.0 tries to play is to really bridge these worlds, because I'm a PhD gerontologist by training, but I was an engineer in undergrad, and when I was an engineer, I went to conferences over here that talked about technology and engineering. And when I was studying gerontology, I went to gerontology conferences. And what we believe is that these groups need to come together. We also really believe that the older adults need to be involved in the process. So this whole intergenerational aspect that Ken mentioned of, we fundamentally believe that the people who understand the needs in this space the best are older adults themselves and the people who work with them every day. And so we're really passionate about bridging those folks who understand the needs with the people who can build stuff, you know, with the technologists and the designers. And that's really what this challenge is about and why we're so excited to bring students all around the world to focus on these needs. And last year we did cognitive impairment, which again, we feel like part of the role of the Stanford Longevity Center and Aging 2.0 is to shine the light on areas where we want to see more innovation, where the average student might not in their daily life think, today I'm going to ideate around cognitive impairment, or today I'm going to think about what it's like for someone in a wheelchair to navigate, you know, Palo Alto. And so I think what we want to do is shine the light. Say there's huge need, huge opportunity to do good and do well. You can solve important problems that are also a huge market opportunity. So personal mobility is certainly a very interesting topic. Ken itemized a lot of reasons why exercise is critical for personal mobility. We know that exercise is important. We know that having muscle mass as you go into later life is really important for staying healthy and robust and kind of dealing with the challenges that come your way as you age. Another thing that Ken mentioned is, though, this whole wearables trend and this whole fitness and wellness trend, we're seeing a lot of it getting applied to, you know, triathletes and Uber athletes, when in fact a lot of this data collection could be really helpful when we're more trying to manage staying fit in later life. So we want to see that wearables and fitness monitoring come more into the aging space to promote wellness as we age. The other kind of area, there's really three buckets we want people ideating around. The first is this physical activity, exercise side. The second one is in the home. As we know, mobility around the home is such a huge challenge. Lots of barriers inhibiting people from doing their activities of daily living in their homes independently as possible. And then the third one's really around the community. And we know the importance of staying connected in the community, to staying socially connected. But oftentimes our cities are not necessarily designed for aging populations and people with mobility limitations. So we think there's really a whole broad swath of opportunities. It's really ripe for people to think about new innovations. But one of the things we didn't do last year that we added in this year, which we think is really important, is again the voice of the consumer. So what we wanted to do is make sure we don't think we need to guess at what's needed. We think a lot of older adults, if we just ask them, could help us understand what the needs are. And that's really step one in design thinking, is around, you know, put yourself in someone else's shoes, develop empathy for the end user, and really involving older adults in the innovation process we think is critical. So these are just some quotes. We put out a little survey to our consumer panel that we do some research with for Aging 2.0 and ask them just a couple, you know, do you guys have any ideas about mobility challenges? And of course, whenever we ask, the floodgates just get open. You know, everyone's got these pent-up ideas they have and things that they think could be better. And so just a few, you know, thinking around the home, chairs are too low, toilets are too low, all the entrances have slopes, you know, that tennis shoes stick to the carpet. We really encourage student designers to, you know, why don't you go and rent a wheelchair for the day, right? And see what it's like to move around. Or why don't you do some empathy devices like changing your mobility and see what it's like to move around your home, or changing your visibility, sorry. So Stephen is gonna take us through a few of the innovations that we're seeing in the market already to inspire some ideas, but really we think that we wanna see your ideas come January or December, that what students have to think about these new ideas. So thanks so much.
Katie? Indeed. So yeah, so we have now this global network, and we've been seeing over the last couple of years over 1,000 startups, and some of them have been in the mobility space, and we constantly meet more interesting innovators from big companies and small companies. So here's just a selection that illustrates the breadth of innovation. So Sabi is a local company that some of you might know, just sort of taking something really quite simple, say, let's just reinvent a cane. Let's make a cane actually cool, stylish, and something that you actually would actually like to be seen out and about in town. Simple idea, it doesn't have to have any technology, but it just can really take a different approach and really bring this idea of fashion into the older adult market. This is another one. This is a Swedish, Swiss company called Noni. There's a Cadence Biomedical from Seattle that we know about too, which has this idea of an exoskeleton. So this actually is designed to help people. This is designed for factory workers to help lift heavy objects, but also could be perfect for people with mobility issues. It basically becomes a chair that you can wear, and you can set it so you can sit down with this exoskeleton. Lots of different innovations happening here around giving superpowers to people using different kinds of exoskeletons. There's a great little company out of the UK called Oomph Wellness. Essentially, what he's demonstrating here is cheerleading in a chair. They've actually developed a whole wellness, a wellness and a lifestyle program that they're selling into assisted living facilities in the UK in a licensing model, making a lot of money, got some really great investment in the UK, and they're gonna be looking internationally. But this idea of just encouraging people to get active and get engaged and have fun while doing it, and it's also a money spinner. This is another company which is taking, again from the UK, taking a different approach to mobility. It's called Good Gym. It's actually, this is about having younger people run around, and as part of their gym, they all start off together and they run off and they go and meet an older person who's isolated. And so actually they then, for example, take some washing or pick up some shopping or just have a chat, have a cup of tea. But the idea here is that you're engaging intergenerationally, as Katie was mentioning, but you're also allowing people to be mobile. In this case, it's the younger people who are the most active ones. But there's also ways that we can do a lot of innovation around transportation and mobility. For example, Lyft. Has anybody just been using the Lyft Line app? Does people know what I'm talking about? Lyft? So Lyft and Uber are these wonderful new, basically next generation taxi services that you can bring up and get your taxi to arrive on your mobile device. And the idea now that both Lyft and Uber have developed is the social component, where they're actually creating a new model for public transportation, where you can fill a car with two or three people, and it's cheaper for everybody, and it's more convenient, and it's just a wonderful experience. So this idea of creating social journeys, I think there could also be some sort of interesting social engagements happening with these, with this kind of service. Mentioning, for those who are interested, to look up the Age Friendly Cities Initiative. It's a really interesting project by the World Health Organization, and a few cities in the US now being sort of licensed or certified as age friendly. Lots of different ways in which a city can start to think through as being more innovative and being more age friendly. And the big issue is we're seeing this reurbanization into cities, and a lot of older people. I just moved from New York, and it's really a massive increase in the older population there, and they're trying to figure out how they can improve mobility around the cities, and lots of interesting case studies and examples from the WHO. Similarly, also interesting initiatives around the blue zones to make cities livable. And also something as simple as mobile apps. There's just a real integration of the public transport systems into mobile devices now, so I don't have to wait in the rain for 10 minutes because I know the bus will be coming now exactly in 30 seconds and I can just leave my house. So just these are interesting innovations that entrepreneurs are already doing to make life easier for everybody, and it could be specifically relevant to older adults, but a lot of the time older adults don't even know that these are possible and these exist. There's a couple more different takes on it. This is a company called WalkJoy. They have a little device that they strap to your leg, and they can identify if you're going to be, if your gait is off, and you're likely to be able to catch somebody before they fall. As we saw earlier, over one in three adults over 65 fall each year. And then some slightly more sort of lateral thinking. There's a golf analysis here, which is designed to help you have a great golf swing. But again, it's using the power of the mobile phone, and it allows you to be able to decide to see if you're actually as good a golfer as Tiger Woods. Similarly, as a Microsoft Kinect is being used for physiotherapy to allow people to improve the movements they have when they're at home. It saves cost in the system to not necessarily have to go all the time to have an in-person physiotherapist, but you can have some benefits to be able to identify whether you're doing the thing and the movement in the right way. Some wonderful innovations in transportation, local sort of personal mobility. You might have seen the wheelchair out there, which is illustrated down here. Again, this looks nothing like what a wheelchair should look like. Really reinventing the idea of, as Katie always says, big, beige, and boring. This idea of products that don't have to live in the hospital. People actually want to use them. But I think this is a particularly cool idea here, the Firefly up here. Can you see it's a wheelchair which has a superpower? It's basically got a big battery pack on the front, so you can zoom around town with your Firefly wheelchair and you can go twice as fast. How cool is that? It just looks like terrific fun. I'd love to have a go. This thing here called the Kangaroo is a little driving, you can drive your wheelchair into the car. There's another system here out of Jersey called the Agile Life Personal Transportation System. It's just basically a combination wheelchair and bed. So one of the big issues is having, for example, a caregiver trying to do a lifter, somebody who might be heavy, to get them from a wheelchair into the bed. Really, there's lots of very complicated ways. There's people, a lot of injuries that come of it. There's rather complicated contraptions with the high lift. But this actually just has a smooth integrated one button connection between a wheelchair and a bed. I'd be quite surprised if we developed anything quite that sophisticated within the next few months, but this idea is the design that we're interested in. And then just a couple of final ones. This is a great little company out of down south, I think it's Arizona or Texas, called Local Motors. And they run an innovation platform for mobility ideas. And so they develop these concepts, like, again, this personal mobility pod, allowing people to get in and out of the car, or the whatever this is, sort of trike component in a completely different way to rethink what it means to be mobile. And this just made the headlines a couple of years ago, in the last few days, actually. This entire car is printed from a block of plastic. It took them 44 hours on a 3D printer, and the thing works. They entirely printed everything. So just think about that as a resurgence of American manufacturing, or if I wanted to, this is obviously designed to be cool and young and appeal to the hot rod racer, but how easy is it now to just build a new concept like this? So we'd love to see ideas, love to sort of get this creative juices flowing. And just a couple of final words in terms of how we're going to do this. And right now, as of today, the system is now up and running. If you go to movedesign.skill.com, the link is up there. If it's not already, it will be shortly on the Stanford site. It's the same system we used last year, and you'll be able to basically log in, you register, and then put your design together. You're going to need to put the summary, put a picture, put an image. There's a bunch of information that we need from you. In terms of the process, we're kicking it off today. Phase one is happening over the next couple of months. The designs are due in December the 5th. And then we're going to spend a fun Christmas with our wonderful phase one judges, who are going to be reviewing the work over the next few weeks. And then in January, we're going to be announcing these 5 to 8 finalists. And then the process of mentoring happens. And then we're going to be connecting those 5 to 8 finalists with the companies that have already announced the sponsorship, the targets, the ARPs, and the others who are interested in supporting this process. And we'll be connecting the mentors and the finalists to really sort of polish the next phase of the proposals that they're making. And bring people in, as Ken mentioned, in here April the 9th for another event and the finals. So with that, just a final sort of mention that we're going to be supporting through the Aging 2.0 network. We've now got 50 chapters in formation, 10 active around the world, and we've been pushing this messaging out around the to different countries, and we're getting also lots of excitement in. As we heard last year, we had 52 submissions, 15 countries, and we're going to try and beat that comfortably this year. That's our goal. So that's the final word. Just wanted to also mention Ani Whitman has joined the Aging 2.0 team. He's around somewhere. There he is. Wonderful. Ani brings a tremendous amount of support. He's got a lot of connections with his private equity company that are really involved in the mobility space. So we're going to be able to draw on those connections as well. So with that, we'll get down to the content. I will hand it back to Ken.
Thank you, Stephen. So next, it is my great pleasure to introduce the director of the Stanford Center on Longevity, Laura Carstensen. Laura is the founding director of the center and is the Farley Dickinson Junior Professor of Public Policy and Professor of Psychology. Her work has been supported by the National Institute of Aging for over 20 years, and in 2005, she was honored with a Merit Award from the National Institute of Health. With her students and colleagues, she has published more than 100 articles on lifespan development, and I'm very happy to introduce her. Laura?
Thank you, Ken. And Katie and Stephen, it's so fun to work with you on this project. It's one of the most exciting things we do here, I think, at the center. Thank you all for being here and sharing your time with us this evening. It is great to see you here and to begin to help think together about these challenges and these issues. What I thought I would do is to kind of zoom out and sort of put into historical perspective the era in which we're living today. And what I'll argue is that this era we're living in demands science and technology arguably more than any other time in human history. We need you. Let me get right to the bottom line. The 20th century made us a fabulous gift with essentially no strings attached. An extra 30 years for the average person. And that's what we need to begin talking about now. We need to begin to think about supersized lives and how we build a culture that supports them. Now, most of you in this room can expect to certainly make it into your 80s, into your 90s, and lots of you here are gonna live beyond 100. And your children and your grandchildren? Well, a distinguished demographer in Germany recently predicted that the majority of children born since the year 2000, the majority, will live to be 100 and beyond. This is a game changer for every aspect of life as we know it. My grandchildren went to nursery school here at Bing Nursery School on Stanford campus, and occasionally I would pick them up when they got out of school. And you know, I think about longevity all the time. You know, when I'm driving my car and trying to fall asleep at night and so on. So I drive to this nursery school, and all I had to do was just squint my eyes just the tiny bit. And when I looked at the playground and these little ones climbing on the play structures and swinging on the tire swings, what I saw were the first centenarians of the 22nd century. They're here. They're living among us. And it is our job. In fact, I believe it's our duty to build a world that ensures that the majority of them are going to reach 100 and beyond, physically fit, mentally sharp, and financially secure. That's what we need to do. And that really is the mission of the Stanford Center on Longevity. Now, these added years of life are an amazing cultural accomplishment. Just an amazing, stunning advance. And, you know, what we have done. But you know, when you think about it, and you listen to people talk about aging and you watch them respond to aging, most people are not sort of jumping and yelling, oh, great, you know, we're going to be really, really, really old. And, you know, the policymakers, they are very concerned that we're going to run out of money, that these programs that were developed premised on relatively small percentage of the population being old are going to go bust. And the actuaries, well, the actuaries, they are terrified because they just see these numbers going up and up and up with no sign, really, of stopping. Now, I maintain that the reason that people are so negative about aging and so worried is because it's brand new. I mean, old age is brand new, that is. We increase life expectancy dramatically, and culture hasn't caught up. Now, you've heard Katie say this and Ken say this. Culture hasn't caught up. What do we mean by this? Well, culture and the way that we think about this is the crucible that holds science and technology and the built environment and broad social practices and behavioral norms. All of that is part of culture. And humans are exquisitely sensitive to culture. The culture guides us through life, and it ensures whether we will flourish or whether we will fail. And our culture today, the one that is guiding us through life and supporting us or failing to support us, is a culture that evolved around lives half as long as the ones that we're living today. So here's what happened. Here's the situation. More years were added to average life expectancy in the 20th century than all years added to life expectancy across all prior millennia of human evolution combined. In a blink of an eye, in historical terms, we nearly double the length of the lives that we're living. Throughout most of human evolution, life was really short. We don't know for sure what it was on the plains of the Africa savanna, but the estimates are from 18 to 20. I mean, life expectancy on average was short. And in those early years, evolution did indeed act on the aging process, and life got a little bit longer and a little bit longer and a little bit longer at a snail-like pace, acting in the way that evolution does. And then by the 1800s, life expectancy has inched up to the mid-30s. By 1900, life expectancy in this country was 47, and at the end of that century, 77. Today it's 78, nearly 79. And as I say, the actuaries, this trend continues to go up. Three months have been being added to life expectancy at 65 in recent years, every year. So every year, we get, or every 4 years, we're getting an added year of life. This is an amazing shift and change. And across these very same years that life expectancy was going up so dramatically, fertility rates fell by half. So we could have just had longer lives and we wouldn't have seen aging societies, but instead we have half as many babies and people are living twice as long, and that reshapes the distribution of age in the population. So the percentage of aging, of aged people, I should say, in societies is changing, changing dramatically. In the United States in 1900, 4% of the population was over 65. Today, it's 13%, and it will go to 20% by 2030. Now, we're the young kid on the block internationally. In Japan, already 20% of the population is over 65, and it's supposed to go to 28% by 2030. Game changers. These will change every aspect of life as we know it. Now, mind you, we have not, and I repeat, have not, found the fountain of youth. It's not that we haven't looked. Humans started looking for the fountain of youth ever since we understood our own mortality. We used to sail off in ships, and now we turn to laboratories. And as you all know, we now have Calico. So Google's on it. Anything could happen. We could increase lifespan, the capacity of people to live for a particular amount of time. But lifespan is not what changed in the 20th century. It was life expectancy. We do know, so one is a theoretical concept, lifespan, how long, what's the potential? The other is simply an arithmetic mean, how long does a group live? and it's life expectancy that changed. We do know that lifespan could be 120 and beyond. And the reason we know is because the oldest woman ever to have lived died in 1997 at the age of 122. Jean-Louis Calment, French woman, who died after living a very interesting, full, and really kind of marvelous life. And any of you who are uneasy about aging should hear and read about Jean-Louis Calment. There are lots of Calment stories that float around in my world. She made a rap album when she was 110. She played herself in the movie Vincent and Me, making her the oldest actress ever to have been at the age of 114. She was the only person on the planet who'd actually known Vincent van Gogh, and that was a movie. So she was in it. There was a journalist who interviewed her when she was 120 and asked the question, "What sort of a future do you envision?" And Calma paused and said, "A very short one." But my favorite story about Calma, hands down, is about a property deal that she made at the ripe old age of 90. She lived in the French city of Arles. She lived in her own home, and she had every intention of living out her life in this home. As I say, she was very fit and very sharp, and was doing well. But there was this young lawyer, he was 47 years old, and he loved this house, and he wanted to buy it, so he made her an offer to buy the home. She said no. And he would go away, and he'd come back with a better offer, and this went on and on. And one day, he arrives on her doorstep, and he says, "I've got a proposition for you." He says, "I will pay you $400 a month for the rest of your life if you will deed the property to me on your death." So she thinks about it. She says, "Okay." And a contract is drawn up, and over the next 30 years, he pays her more than three times the value of her home. She outlived him by 2 years. He died at 77. But they had become friends, and he had attended her birthday party, 120th, shortly before he died. And they were overheard talking, and she had turned to him at one point, and she said, "You know, we all make bad deals." So that's what 120 can look like. But you know, the story of how we as a society somehow launched ourselves into this era of very long life really doesn't begin with a discussion about older people at all. It begins with a story about babies. In 1900 in this country, 25% of babies died before they reached 5. Many more died before they reached 12. And death was common at all ages. Maternal mortality was very, very high. Very few families escaped the death of one of its close members at some point during their lives. Life expectancy thus went up largely because fewer of the youngsters died. It was those kinds of changes in the 20th century that increased this average. And what has essentially happened is that this population pyramid, you remember population pyramids we learned about in school, with many at the bottom winnowed to a tiny peak at the top, which represented the population in the United States and in every single country around the planet in 1950. Those population pyramids are being reshaped into rectangles. And what this means is that for the first time, the vast majority of babies are having the opportunity to grow old. And if you're the kind of person who can get chills from biostatistics, these are the ones that should do it. I mean, this reshaping, this unprecedented change that's allowing old age to become a typical stage in life, a normative stage in life, is a gift that was handed to us from our ancestors. How did it happen? Well, here we get down to what's going on tonight. The short answer to that question is science and technology. Science and technology brought about those kinds of changes that allowed us to live far longer than any of those ancestors ever could have imagined. You know, I'm really amused when I hear, and I often do, and I know you do too, I hear young people say how much more technologically proficient they are than their grandparents and great-grandparents. Our grandparents and great-grandparents were so technologically proficient, they doubled the length of life. Top that. Top that. These changes came about because of something that Nobel laureate Bob Vogel and his colleague Dora Costa called technophysioevolution. Evolution not by biological or natural selection, but evolution through technological advances. In the 20th century, agricultural technologies became so effective that for the first time in history, we had a steady food supply throughout the year. Never before had that occurred. Electricity was discovered and then harnessed and became widely available in every American household. And with electricity comes refrigeration. And imagine the safety of the food supply and how it improves when refrigeration is available in virtually every American home. Pasteurization of food, purification of the waterways contributed dramatically to a reduction in the spread and perpetuation of disease. The systematic disposal of waste represented a dramatic increase in a reduction of contagious disease. And there are historians who write that we have our garbage collectors, technologists, to thank as much as our physicians for this increase and life expectancy. We are no genetically different to our knowledge than our ancestors were 10,000 years ago. But because of technology, our vital organs have greatly improved. Average body size increased by 50%. It's now getting a little out of hand. But malnutrition was the problem throughout most of history. We are taller today by a couple inches than our ancestors were 150 years ago. And our brains process information faster. All of this is changing because of science and technology. And of course, we came to live a lot longer. So here we are, standing at a point in history when four, five, and conceivably six generations may be alive at the same time. To put this in perspective, today, a 20-year-old has a greater chance of having a living grandmother than a 20-year-old had of having a living mother 100 years ago. Families have changed irrevocably. And so, you know, you would think, since science and technology are the reasons for this advance, that science and technology would be all over this, trying to find ways that we could use science and technology to ensure happiness, health, and prosperity as we live far longer lives. And it's particularly curious the technology community has kind of decided to sort of sit it out until recently, until Aging 2.0 and some other really interesting developments. And, you know, I think a lot of this is because people sort of give up on aging. You know, that there's this deep-seated belief that there's nothing you can do about it, that as we grow older, we're going to just do more poorly on every aspect of life. And that's been the kind of belief. And if that's your belief, there's just not a lot of inspiration to go in and change it. If that's your belief and your work in technology, then the kinds of technologies you develop are ones that come in at end stage. They're technologies that help the most frail, the sickest people, not technologies necessarily that are going to transform the way that we age. In fact, if you Google technology and aging, almost every site that comes up is about healthcare. You gotta go, so old people, the only thing we're gonna do is provide healthcare? Now, do not misunderstand me. We need to provide better healthcare and we need better healthcare technologies, but that's not all of what life is about past 65. In fact, the vast majority of people 65 years old are living independently in their own homes, on their own, and making contributions to families and communities. What does that population want and need from technology? Now, there are some very thoughtful, interesting, imaginative new products on the market, Lively and Aging 2.0 group that has been supported by them, are coming on the market with sensor-based systems that are really beautiful, low-touch technologies that connect families through activity sharing so that people know when one another is safe. And then, of course, we have elegant, beautiful, aesthetically pleasing technologies that help people who have very severe disabilities, like the serving set that was developed by Sha Yao and won last year's design challenge. So there are some really beautiful, innovative technologies, but we need to do more. We need a lot more. And when I think about the technology space and aging, I think the biggest hole may be the technologies that we need to develop that will help young people grow old well. And that's a hole that continues to exist. For the first time in history, most young people living in the developed world are going to live longer than they ever thought they would. Almost all of them are going to not only reach old age, they're going to be old for decades. And we need to find ways that we can help that process. We need technologies that help people transform and transport themselves into the future. The human brain did not evolve to plan 20, 30 years into the future. Nothing in our evolutionary heritage helped us to do that. Technologies, virtual reality, some of that being done by Jeremy Balinson here at Stanford, can help in aiding people with that. We need technologies that can monitor people's spending habits and help them make good decisions. We need technologies that will help keep people physically fit. And that's why we're here tonight. I recently was teaching a class at Stanford, and I asked this large group of Stanford students, how many of you look forward to being 80? And one hand went up. And then I said, what if I told you that you could be fit and sharp and financially secure at 80? And more than half of the hands go up. Now people are sort of interested in this. But there were a couple students sitting down in the front, and they were sort of talking to each other and giggling, and I looked over at them and I said, and how about if I could add good looking? And I had every one of them. We need to start aiming higher and change the culture of human aging. And I want to thank all of you for being partners in that tonight. Thank you.
Yeah, you know, I think, again, this is something Aging 2.0 is doing, involving older people in technology development. You know, again, I think it's really hard when you're 20 to think about your people who are 80. You know, it's like Martians, you know, sort of, you know, ooh, you know, I see them. They move. I think I'll do this, you know, but they sort of think, well, maybe we can help them use Twitter better. And, you know, older people are actually not as interested in having expansive new social networks as they are in focusing on a few very select people they care and know very well. And so some of it is just becoming familiar. You know, one of the problems we've had, I think, with prior ages is that, and I mean eras, is that we've got incredible age segregation, which made sense if life expectancy is going to be 47. Then you got to get your education early, get a job, reproduce, have a family, whatever, retire, and you're dead. When you have life expectancies of 90 and 100, that's not a good model. One of the things we could do is to begin to have leisure before retirement, have young people in the workplace in high school, in college, taking breaks, figuring out what they want to do. So we could reduce age segregation, and then I think we'll get more of that contact. But for now, I really do think a good idea is to have older people think about what it is they need.
Maybe one more. Layla, if you want to set up hold.
I'd be interested to hear a little more about the relationship between what you're doing and the transhumanist community, which focuses a lot on sort of human augmentation through technology, but at all stages of life. Mm-hmm. It seems like there could be a lot of synergies, mm-hmm. and I'm wondering if that conversation has started or not.
Well, Ken would know more about it if it's starting in the center. It's certainly something we're interested in. You know, it makes me think of the exoskeletons and so on, and that kind of technology that could be developed, or an iPhone, all this. We have great interest in all technologies that could improve quality of life.
Thanks.
Well, I'd like to thank Dr. Carstensen.
So at this point, I'd like to introduce Dr. Layla Takayama. So Layla is a research scientist and is here representing the World Economic Forum's Global Agenda Council on Robotics and Artificial Intelligence. Layla has quite a number of things on her resume here. I'm reading through her bio. She's been at PARC at one point, and I'll make it short. Nokia Research Center, Willow Garage, and is now a senior researcher at Google X. She has been named a young global leader by the World Economic Forum, and one of Technology Review's 35 Innovators Under 35 and Fast Company's 100 Most Creative People in Business in 2012. Layla, thank you for coming.
Thanks, Ken. Also, this is where I hail from, so I did grad school here at Stanford, like just over there, so it's nice to be back. I should have made it much shorter. So thanks for having me here. I'm actually here mostly talking on behalf of the World Economic Forum. I'll talk a bit about, you know, what that is and how the WEF is planning to be actually supporting the design challenge at the end of this talk. But I kind of just wanted to give you a flavor of the kinds of things that me, who works mostly in a technology field, how we keep stumbling into the area of building technologies for the lifespan, in order to start thinking more about how we do that in a more purposeful way. So I just want to tell you a little story to begin with. I started by working on these robots. You saw some pictures of these before. This is the PR2 that was actually developed here at Stanford, started here at Stanford. PR2 stands for Personal Robot 2 in Ken Salisbury's lab in mechanical engineering, who's actually back there now. That was the wooden prototype. This is the plastic and metal prototype that lives in, you know, a few dozen different universities. And at that time, I was told, okay, you're a psychologist, you do that social science stuff, you deal with the humans, and we'll deal with the robot. And I was like, oh, okay, this is going to be interesting. So for 4.5 years, I worked at this place just down the street in Menlo Park called Willow Garage, and we were really focused on open source robotics, meaning trying to get people to build on each other's code and contribute to a community of software, as opposed to everyone building little robots in their little closets, writing code that would only run on their little robots. And getting them to be more of a sort of building on the shoulders of giants kind of community. While we were there, we actually had a coworker who was remote, and his name was Dallas. Dallas lived in Indiana, and you know, most of us here like living in California, but he hates being in California because it's really expensive, right? Like, I mean, just look at the real estate in Palo Alto, it's crazy. So he's like, well, I wanna have a California salary, and I really like my coworkers there, but I'm gonna live at home. Dang it, I am not moving to the West Coast. So we're like, fine, he's a really good electrical engineer, we'll put up with that. So this is what he looked like at every single meeting I went to with him. He was the voice in the box on the table, and that's not such a compelling way to be present in the office, right? Because literally we'd have arguments where people would be screaming at each other about some technical specification that had to be decided upon, and if someone didn't like what Dallas was saying, they would hang up on him. And so he really did not have much of a presence in the space. It was very frustrating. So what they then did, of course, because it's a bunch of roboticists, is we put a laptop running Skype on a cart that could be pushed around the office. And actually, many people compare this to being in a wheelchair. So he would get pushed into meetings and then pushed into talks. And it was kind of okay, because then at least I know what his face looks like, sorta. But then he would be in a space like this, and he'd be, you know, sitting off in the corner somewhere, and you'd hear him being like, "Turn me to the right, I can't see the screen." And the whole room heard it. And so that wasn't so great. And so one weekend, Kurt, his buddy in Dallas, got together when he happened to be in California for the weekend, and they built this. So he rolled into the office, basically like Skype on a stick on wheels. And we didn't know what to call it, so first we're like, well, it's DallasBot. No, but Dallas is in Texas, so we're gonna call it TexEye. And the coolest thing about it was he could barge into your office when you didn't answer his email, and he wouldn't move from that doorway until you answered. And if you got into an argument, he literally did this. Two guys were arguing in the hallway, and he rolled between them and physically inserted himself into the discussion and, like, didn't really get his way, but he at least was heard. And we actually felt bad about shutting him off, the same way that you could easily hang up on him when he was just the table box voice. So it was really interesting because we're like, wow, you know, maybe this thing that we don't want to call a robot, but, you know, it's like Skype on a stick, is pretty powerful. And so what we did was we made a bunch more of these because we're like, well, maybe we just like it because, like, we like robots. And, you know, that's not a real product if only we buy the thing that we make. And so we're building these things. You may have seen it before. If you watch The Big Bang Theory, that is ShellBot. We did not copy them. They called us up when they saw our YouTube video, and they're like, we want one of those. And make it look a little more hacky. So they actually, like, took off a bunch of parts and had, like, wires hanging out the side to make it look cooler, like more Caltech-like. Caltech's great. And the new commercial version of this, you may have seen at places like TED, where Snowden was actually using these to beam into the TED conference and be on stage without physically being president of the United States, because there would be ramifications for him if he did that in person. So just to give you a sense of, like, the research we've done here, we were really curious to know, like, you know, what if normal people use these? What if it wasn't geeks like us? And so we put them in a whole bunch of companies around the Bay Area, used a bunch of, you know, sort of qualitative research methods in order to figure out, like, what are people really going to do with this? You know, what are they not going to use it for? How are they going to hijack it? And they did. These are the locations where the remote operators were located, but all of their robotic bodies were physically present in the Bay Area here. So, you know, what do people do? If you look across the board, you know, people kind of do what they do normally. They exchange ideas, they ask questions, they get answers, they show off, they socialize. And I think what's even more interesting than what they do is where they did it. So if you think about, like, your normal video conferencing systems, you see them in the big meeting rooms, right? Like, maybe one's down the hall. But if you look at where these robots are used, they're actually used in the hallways and in communal spaces. So the people who are really effective at using them discovered that if you hang out by the coffee machine, that's where people are held captive for about 2 minutes while their coffee is percolating. And so that's when you can chit-chat with them because you know they're available, just sort of like not doing anything else anyway. The other thing they would do is sort of roam the hallways and pounce on people who didn't look like they were in a big rush. And so you sort of build this social presence in the space too. There's three big things that we saw happening here. One was just like showing up, you know, like coming here physically, bothering to, you know, come after work to be at a conference and sit your butts in a chair shows commitment to the design challenge. It shows commitment to this group of people, and that's a big deal. And even though it might not be quite the same as being there in a robot, you know, coming here in person, sometimes you just can't be there in person. And so depending on what the alternative is, this can actually be a really good way to communicate to your team that you care enough to be there. Another one, of course, is capturing attention, right? So standing in the hallway is a good way, or blocking the doorway is a good way of getting someone to answer your question. One story that I like to tell about this one is you could actually hear it coming down the hallway because the wheels would make this like wee little sound. And sometimes I would have an email in my inbox that Dallas had sent me with a question that I didn't want to answer. And if I heard it coming, I would run out the door the other way because I could run faster than the robot could move. And then he wouldn't find me, and I'd go out the exit door because I knew he couldn't open the doors. And then I go into the email because I didn't want to talk to him about it. So, you know, there's workarounds. We've made them more quiet so they can sneak up on you now if they wanted to. The last one that's kind of feels touchy-feely, but it's actually, I think, the most important, was building social connections. So, you know, we had this pool table at work and we play pool and we weren't very good at it, but it was sort of a bonding thing that we do after work. And these guys can't play pool because the robots didn't have arms, but they could heckle the guys playing pool and make fun of them when they made bad shots. And that actually helped to build this sense of like you as a human being, not just you as my coworker who I only use because you're useful to me in the meetings. And it was a really nice way to actually see more of a social connection being built and creating a sense of teamness as opposed to like we're just a group of people who work in the same space. Many people, when I would show them this work, would say like, oh, that'd be great for visiting grandma in the retirement community, which felt a little offensive to me. And I was like, you know, what if grandma doesn't want that? What if she wants something else? What if grandpa wants something else? And so we decided to actually engage with the Avenidas community in Palo Alto and say, all right, let's actually work with the community that you all think you're talking about and figure out like, what did they want? Not what do we want and wish upon them, but like, what is it that the people who we think we'd be helping would actually be interested in and worried about? And so we decided to have a bunch of, older adults who are living independently in the Palo Alto area come over and actually try the robot, right? Not talk about robots in this abstract sci-fi crazy way, but like really drive it around and really get to be visited by someone in the robot and have an experience before talking about, speculating about what a technology is and is not and is good for and is bad for. So we did a lot of interviews here. I remember a lot of people said, I want to visit grandma, it's going to be the grandchildren. It's all about the grandchildren. Actually, it's all about the buddies and the friends and those people who are really important to maintain those tight social connections to. The important people in your lives do include the grandchildren, but it's not only the grandchildren. And that was really important. One really funny one that we kept hearing was like, I don't want my kids coming in whenever they want. Like, they need to knock. Like, I need to have a way of like not answering the phone. Maybe I don't feel like talking to my kids today. Like, it's my space. Another, you know, one of the big benefits, of course, is reducing social isolation. But also, you know, what if you could visit your doctor via one of these telepresence robots instead of having to get in the car and go to the hospital because you really just don't feel up to it today, but you probably should get that checkup. So reducing travel time, for example, could be one of those things that we might be able to do. The biggest concern I thought was going to be safety, because having worked around robots, I worry all the time about robot safety. They run over your toes, they could smush you against walls, like there's all kinds of things that can go wrong. But the number one thing they worried about was actually etiquette, because we've spent decades now building up this social etiquette around telephones where, you know, you can talk to my answering machine, that's okay, because I just don't feel like talking at this moment. You don't get to dictate when we're going to have an interaction. And that was by far the biggest worry. In the numbers, it doesn't look really big, but in the conversations, it was the most deeply felt concern about this technology. And actually, if we looked back at the other studies we'd done in offices, there were a few people who were kind of annoying to their coworkers. And if they were annoying, what would happen to their robot is it would get put in a closet. And so they could log into the robot, but then they'd have to knock on the door to get out of the closet, which gave their coworkers the opportunity to just like be like, oh, we weren't there. We didn't hear you knocking. Sorry, I guess you can't come in today. And so having some control over when you want to interact and not interact was also very important. Finally, this was my favorite finding from the whole study. Everyone kept saying we want to visit grandma in the retirement community, but actually the thing that people were the most excited about was getting out, not having people come in, right? I want to go to that baseball game and heckle those players with my friends in the stadium. That's different from watching it on TV. I want to be part of that scene, part of that audience, part of that crowd at the concert, and not necessarily just like sitting at home and having people visit me all the time. Because there's sometimes some places that I've been, like I've been to Yankee Stadium and I want to go back there, but it's really expensive and it's kind of a pain to get there. And like, yeah, I'll go to the local game, but I don't really feel like doing a cross-country flight. Other spaces that are really interesting for them in this particular set of people was going to museums, going to theater performances, and basically like flipping the entire equation on its head, right? Because originally we'd gone in hearing like, oh, you should put them in the retirement community. And really what they were saying was, no, put it everywhere else out in the world. And by the way, it's not just for us, right? My mom happens to be going to Paris now for the first time in her entire life, and she's ecstatic about it. But what if she could have gone earlier, right? What if it didn't have to cost so much to go to these exotic places that we wish we could go to, and for some reason or other, we just can't? So in that case, I think robotic telepresence could be an interesting potential option. I do want to mention that, you know, none of this research is done just by me. I have a lot of really great collaborators, many of whom have now scattered to the winds because Willow Garage has imploded, but many have scattered and landed at Google. So we're still in the local area, and right now I'm at Google X. But today I'm actually here on behalf of the World Economic Forum, and I just kind of wanted to give you guys a little bit of a background for what that is. When they first called me up, I had no idea who they were, so don't be embarrassed if you didn't know either, because I had no idea. So the World Economic Forum is a nonprofit organization that's actually not linked to any particular political group or partisan group or even a national group. So they are based in Sweden. If you've ever heard of the Davos Conference, that's the one they run. And people like me volunteer for them in order to help them figure out what are the things that those people in Davos should be talking about. Laura is in the Agent Council, and like, we actually met together at that conference where we were setting up the agenda for all of these world leaders to go talk to. So it's kind of a nice venue for like bringing real content to the discussions that are happening up at that higher level. They're really committed to tackling sort of the major trends that are impacting global economies, right? Thinking about going from the pyramid to the rectangle is a big deal for the global economy, not just for one country, but like everybody. Everybody's worried about this. Some countries are going to get hit with it a little bit earlier, and the better we can be prepared for that and actually lean into it and do good with it, the better, the more prepared we'll be for that new future. As part of that effort, they set up these things that are called the Global Agenda Councils. And what that means is you have a set of experts in each one of the fields. So I'm in the Council on Robotics and AI. There's a Council on Aging. There's other councils on things like megacities and different, you know, different world's regions. And the idea is that we come together, we meet as councils, and we talk across the councils to help figure out, like, what are the big risks? What are the big changes happening in the world, and what are the things that like we really need to be thinking about at a global level, not just at a local level. This is actually my third year on the council, and even though, you know, robotics and AI sounds like a very technical thing and all we do is think about robots all day, most of our council is actually people who are social scientists who are really worried and actively working on more of the social, the political, the cultural issues surrounding all of these technologies. And we fortunately got to meet up with the Council on Aging in Abu Dhabi last year, and we were talking about, like, you know, people keep talking about, like, we should be using robots for older adults, but we don't really know how. And so, you know, talk with us, like, what are the problems? What are the needs? Because we don't want to end up in a situation where we, for example, put robots in a retirement community for no good reason. That would be terrible, and that's a waste of time for everyone. So, together, our two councils decided that this would be a good chance to support the Stanford Center on Longevity in the design challenge, because this is the perfect convergence of having an emerging technologies combined with design thinking and really deeply understanding, you know, what is it like to grow older? What is it like to be mobile in different ways? And to make that's in a way that's not stigmatizing, right? Like, it doesn't have to be a technology for this population of people. It can be for everyone at all ages, right? We thought those telepresence robots would be great for young tech workers in the Bay Area, and it's turning out that they're actually useful for many different kinds of niches that were not expected before, because being socially connected to others is this deeply felt human need that doesn't just exist for, you know, tech workers. So we're going to be supporting the design challenge in a few different ways, just promoting it through the networks, trying to get more people to be supporting and participating in the challenge, helping out with the selection committee. And we're also adding a prize for the business participants who are going to be anyone who puts in an entry that's very technology oriented. We're going to be setting up a new prize just for that particular type of contribution to the design challenge. And the details of that are getting worked out over the next couple of months, but feel free to ping me if you have any questions about it. And my colleagues, David Peters and Corey Lathan, have been really leading that charge, working with Ken and figuring out how we're going to make that happen. So with that, I'll take questions.
Are there any questions for Layla?
June?
I think I'm going to be agile and provocateur again. It was a very exciting kind of thing, but I was a little disturbed by your, I think, next to last slide, when you had the council on aging.
Yeah.
Or both of your councils.
Yeah.
I can see only one person there who might be aged.
Oh, so these are, sorry. These are actually just selected headshots. That's one person from each council. But
well,
it is a weird shot. They all look pretty young. Yeah, that is a good point.
And I think you need to have older people. Because not only do we want to interrelate with you, and I'm very excited of hearing some ideas that I've been pushing at being put up, but we want to be also in a sense of leadership.
Right.
And it isn't that we'll take over the leadership, but we want to be part of that.
Yeah,
and my first recommendation would be to expand that council and have some people who are aged on it. And still have their wits. We all agree that some of us sometimes are not always with it, but that would be helpful also.
Even for young people, right?
We're having somebody who has some difficulties on the council might be helpful.
Yeah, I think that's a great recommendation.
Other questions? Stephen?
Presentation. Thanks. I guess I had a sort of definitional question. What is a robot? Because I see that beam thing, and to me it looks like an iPad on wheels.
Yeah.
And to me, a robot has its own mind, and it's going to take over the world.
Yeah.
What is a robot?
It is a very deep philosophical question, and it depends who you ask. So my personal definition of it is very, very broad. So in my sense, you know, anything that can sort of sense something in the world, make a decision about it, and then take an action on it, would be a robot. So in my very, very loose sense, right, a thermostat is a robot. And actually, if you look at places like Nest, right, Yoki Matsuoka, who is one of the leading technologists on it, she's a roboticist, and she's working on thermostats. Because I think once robots become useful, they stop being called robots. They start being called thermostat, or washing machine, or dishwasher, right? Because they have a function, they have a value. And so, in some sense, robots are things that are not useful, but they're they're often things that are in research, right? We're still trying to figure out. It's like saying computer. Like, computer used to mean it's a calculator, but now it means something more. In the beam, in particular, it is telepresence, right? And they actually don't call it a robot. They call it, I think, a remote presence device or something like of that type, because there is no autonomy in it. We did try adding autonomy to it. So, for example, many people would run into the walls or run into each other with it because it's hard to drive. And so we added obstacle avoidance. So just like the self-driving car that won't hit, you know, a traffic light or a post, this thing wouldn't let you run into a wall. And people actually got really frustrated with that because they're like, I wanted to knock on the door and now you're not letting me hit any obstacles. So now I can't knock on the door, so no one will let me out of the closet, right? And so we have to be really careful about, like, when and where we add autonomy. But, yeah, what is a robot is one of those questions I think is never going to go away. and I have a feeling, hopefully, you know, the kinds of projects that we'll see here at the Design Challenge are going to be so darn useful that we won't have to call them robots at all. But you could still use that stuff as in the back end. Yeah, we've got time.
In that case, just a quick follow-up. There's a conference in the UK recently which looked at the ethics of robots, and the conclusion, the net-net, was that the Isaac Asimov rules, you know those, were still valid as far as they're concerned. I wondered if you had any thoughts on ethics and robots.
Are we on record?
No. Nobody's tweeting this.
We are on video.
We are on video. We should talk offline. But my Asimov was a scientist, but the laws actually came from his fiction writing. Which is a different lens, I think, to interpret his laws. And most of his laws are actually incredibly hard to implement. So, for example, you know, robotic perception or computer vision, it's still really hard to tell a person apart from a tree in many, many cases. And so if you tell it, you know, don't hurt people, it doesn't even know what a person is to begin with. And so it's really hard to act on those laws. And so one of the things I've been thinking about recently actually has been like, what would the laws be that we could actually implement such that they would do no harm, really? But Asimov, you know, took a start at it, but that's not where I would stop.
I'd like to thank Layla for the talk this evening. That was really interesting.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Funny.
And we definitely look forward to working with the Global Agenda Councils. I was just recently talking to somebody about the Global Shapers, which is actually another group of the World Economic Forum made up of millennials who create their own chapters. I think there are 280-some chapters worldwide who have offered to help get their universities and their local areas involved. So we're very excited about that. So next, this is going to be very interesting. I'm looking forward to this panel. So I'd first like to introduce Lauren Grieco, who works up in the mobility division at the Center on Longevity. And she's going to kind of set this up and give you some background about how this all came to be and what you're about to see, and then turn it over to the panel. Thanks, Lauren.
All right. Welcome, everyone, once again. So in line with all of the previous ideas around really needing to develop technologies and address issues around aging, mobility, but also across the lifespan, the ideas keep coming up that we need to develop more specified needs. And it's not enough for people right now, developers to create all these needs based off their own experience. We actually need to go to the user population and ask them what their thoughts are on this. So in line with that, we brought together a group of seniors from the community and top designers from IDEO to actually walk a number of people through this design thinking process in order to actually develop user specified needs straight from the horse's mouth, if you will. So basically what we did was have the IDEO leaders give a talk on Design Thinking 101 and then break into groups and ideate around needs for different areas. So we had participants from Stanford Emeriti, Avenidas, and the Bay Area community. So thank you everyone for participating. Some of which are here today, and we're going to have a workshop panel after this to actually talk a little bit more about that. Thanks to IDEO as well for moderating this. Wonderful job getting ideas from our participants. And so our specific goals were to generate areas of focus to actually give to designers. So through the design thinking methodology, people categorized ideas based on personal needs, home, and community. And then what we're going to do is actually process all this data, a lot of which we've already done, and then make it useful and available to student designers so that they can actually have a repository to go to of ideas that they can then use to inform their design subsequently. So I'm just going to give you a quick summary of some of the top problem areas and target areas for each theme. So the first theme was staying active. And so as you can see here, the top three themes that came up were availability and access. So that's basically availability to things in their environment that would help them to be more active. Also access. So a lot of times people would like to get their hands on some sort of design or solution, but that's not necessarily an option for a lot of different reasons. So lack of comfort. This was resonated around things like ergonomics, exercise equipment not being useful. People with mobility impairments, but also people that may have a nagging knee injury, and so their treadmills hurt their knees. Affordability, that's a big topic right now. A lot of focus on designing for affordability in multiple areas. So that's something that we'd like our designers to keep in mind as they're going about creating solutions for this year's challenge. And then for the community, some of the top areas were, so this idea of community is where I am at that moment. So it's not necessarily this sort of historical idea that we've had of just a physical space that one lives in, but it's really people move around, you know, their community can be multiple places. And so another idea that came up a lot was a need for cultivating social networks with age, and not just technologically like Facebook, Twitter, things like that, but physical environments. So we need to stress that, especially for our young designers, that this actual physical social network is something that's still very important and needs to be maintained and cultivated throughout the lifespan. And then another idea was a lack of awareness for existing resources. So you can imagine multiple solutions around that, but basically harnessing what we already have available and making that more usable to people. And then the third area was the home. And so something that really resonated was the idea that psychological and our emotional are just as important as physical welfare. So a lot of times around mobility, we seem to focus on the physical sphere and physiology more so than perceptions, psychological states, emotional states that accompany the physicality of certain situations. So if people can really design for keeping that in mind, that would be very useful. The idea of just one misstep is all that it takes. Falls are a huge problem, as most of you know. Really, if somebody has one fall, they can be permanently disabled and multiple other negative outcomes. So really this idea of being cognizant at all times of preventing that one misstep and how you work around that, because again, it's not an easy solution. If people are always staring at their feet, they don't get to enjoy life. One participant said, I never see the sun, moon, and stars because I'm always looking at my toes. So really thinking about issues like this. And then lastly, the idea that not all falls or accidents are require true emergency services. So right now, most of the infrastructure is set up such that if there's an emergency, the ambulance is sent, the fire trucks are sent, you know, all out emergency situation. But one of our caretakers brought up the point that if someone falls, you know, the need is not around all of that really alarming response to come, that we just need solutions to help a caretaker get the person back up onto their feet. So there's this real need for intermediary services. So with that, I would like to turn it over to Katie Fike and our panel. Our panel of speakers today are drawn largely from the workshop that we held last week here. And they'll give a brief introduction of their name, affiliation, and I think a couple ideas that they think are important around mobility, and then turn it over to the audience for discussion.
Great.
Thank you.
Thanks. All right. I think these microphones are on. Perfect. All right, this is the first test in mobility. How accessible was our stage? How'd we do? Well, thank you guys. I want to just first let you guys know that, let's see, the first four of us were all together last week for the ideation, and then Kevin is here through our relationship with the Davis Finney Foundation, so he was not one of the participants, but I think is another great example of how can we learn from people what they really need and want in their lives. And I think that's really come up as a theme today is, you know, what do people really want? And one other thing that I took from Laura's talk is, you know, we talk about compression of morbidity a lot. And I think today we're looking for design challenges that can compress mobility limitations. You know, how can we keep your mobility long, and then at the very end, maybe you're not quite so mobile. But how can we help you stay as mobile as possible? So what we wanted to start with was just have each of you introduce yourself. And then, you know, it's been about a week since we did the design challenge. And I'm wondering, you know, after a week of it percolating and maybe looking at your daily life a little bit differently, what's one area that stands out for you as an important area for a need for innovation and around mobility? So name and need, please. Paul brought notes. I love it.
And I thought that workshop was excellent, by the way, and I heard lots of good ideas. I did have a chance to think about it more since the workshop and also talk to some of the people in the aging community that I'm in touch with. And I thought rather than maybe talk in principles, that I could make my points by giving some specific examples of things that would be needed.
Perfect.
And I don't know if this is the right moment.
Yep, so we'll each spend just a minute or two on these, and then we can move a circle back around.
Okay, I need about three or four, if that's okay.
Let's hear your first two ideas.
Okay, so in no particular order, one of the important things is that small tweaks to existing products can have enormous benefits. And a lot of the products out there are just not quite right. And I have things in mind, for example, shoes and slippers around the house, flooring materials, handrails that maybe should be made adjustable, and things of that kind. I have another good one here, and that is things like walkers and canes should be made a little sexy. That is, they can be fashion statements, and people should be proud to show them off. And just to get as an example of things that could be done, and these are all small tweaks to existing products that could make a world of difference to the people who use them.
That's wonderful. So I think that's a great design principle for the students is look at something that already exists and just make it a little bit better, whether it's something that's not for aging right now but needs to be tweaked for someone who might have some changes, or just make things more sexy. I think that's a good call, Paul. And if you all have not met Molly in the back, Molly is a fantastic example with boas on her wheelchair, and you know, she's the only thing she said's original on there are the wheels and the motor. And you know, that ability though to tweak and personalize and make something work for you and make something feel like an expression of you, I think in mobility in particular, there's huge need for that. So we'll come back to more of your great ideas. But you can see why we need to tap into the wisdom of people who actually are challenging some of these things, because you have all these ideas, we just had to ask.
My name is Sasmik Serovian. I've been in user-focused design for many, many years in high tech. And I am amazed that this area is just being addressed recently. I'm quite amazed. I am at the opposite end. I'm going to go way up to 30,000 feet. And the thought I had after last week was that there's a tendency to focus on hardware products. And there's a tremendous amount that can be done with just software. And my worry is that what an 18-year-old can handle in software is not necessarily what an 80-year-old handles in software. So our experience is to address the younger user, but I think it's very important to also focus on how the older user. And one specific example I have there is older users will not be as visually responsive as they would be to words. So we tend to use a lot of icons, a lot of things. You know, if you ask, this has happened to me, how will you turn it on any device? They don't know what the symbol is for on and off, you know. And so it's better to have a word there that says on and off than to do the symbol. And that's just a small example of the larger challenge of a lot of this interaction is going to be on some screen of some kind, mm-hmm. and there is a lot to be done with words. Please use words. Yeah. To be louder?
I think we just kind of make sure we're speaking into that.
Okay. That's sort of my one big thought. Mm-hmm. I can also, I was the one who was complaining that there was no way to lift somebody up without calling emergency. There are many, many hardware pieces that I can imagine. I was very intrigued by that chair that you can sort of put together and sit in it. Something like that would be could be improved and become this thing that lifts you up. So there's tremendous room for hardware stuff too.
So I think on the software side, this idea that we need to be doing user testing, you know, early and often with older adults,
yes.
and what we might think is intuitive to someone who grew up with an iPhone attached to their hand their whole life is really different than the first time you interact with the technology.
Right.
And I think that's one of the beautiful things about doing this iterative, especially with software. You can change it. You can test and try and see what works
yes.
best.
Yes.
And I think another thing to keep in mind is this caregiver perspective. So we talk about the older adult, we also talk about a lot of people who came to the event were mm-hmm. had older parents or mm-hmm. were caring mm-hmm. for a spouse. And so we can also be thinking about designing products that help increase the mobility of someone via the caregiver. There's gait belts, there's all these different tools to help. How can we think of even better ways that the caregiver can help empower the end user? All right, and this is Ellen, right?
Yes, I'm Ellen Erbrock, and I have the good luck to have been born so that I was in my 50s when Steve Jobs introduced the first computer for personal use. And so I had the chance to get on the wagon of technology at an early stage, and I did that through Avanitas, the senior center, which had a computer learning center, which showed us was the opportunity to learn. They did it with the old-fashioned screens. They didn't have any computers at that time. But I took time off from work to cut out and go and take these classes. And so I've been really part of that society ever since my 50s. And I have been active at Avanitas, both as a member of Avanitas and active with their Computer Learning Center. And I've been a great advocate of public transportation. It was also in my 50s that I realized that I did not like to drive to San Francisco, but I did like to go to the symphony. And so I decided that I wasn't going to quit going to the symphony. I learned to master the public transportation possibilities here in California. We're really very fortunate, and even fortunate here in Palo Alto. It is an alternative as a way to do, and I think the major problems seniors have are transportation and communication there. And for me, the most important thing at my age is that I want to stay an active part of my community and a productive part. And one of the ways I'm doing it is that I've been selected by the city manager to be on a panel that is working on the long-range plans for Palo Alto, and they have to have a new comprehensive plan. This keeps me involved with all sorts of people in the community, meeting once a month, and it's just very, very satisfying. And I think the two things that are important are being involved and feeling that you're a part of the community, and also never underestimate when you're designing things for seniors the importance of feeling attractive and active and a part of the community. That vanity is a very, very strong motive.
That's great.
I'm Frank. I'm Frank Sabella, and I've worked in businesses for about 30 years. And my interest stems just generally, I've always been interested in the demographics of aging, but also from the standpoint that now I'm beginning to get older. And for all you young people, it actually does happen. You begin to start to notice these things, these subtle changes, and you begin to start thinking about, can you really go up and down the stairs? Is there something you have to think about? So, but I'm really here because I want to make sure that you not only design mobility products, but something to make sure that I can keep all my hair in about 30 years too. So, but I would say that really that the interesting thing about getting older is. And we've touched on this, is the community, the perception of old people in the community. And as I mentioned last week, when you look at advertisements and various other forms of media, and you can see, you begin to notice as you get older that you're not there. Okay, so part of the design thinking is to make sure that you recognize that seniors want to be in the community. They want to participate. They want to keep doing what they're doing. If you ask me what I want to be able to do what I do today in 30 years, in 40 years. So you need to keep that in mind when you think about your products, that we are not just sort of shunted off in some corner somewhere. And as you said, we want things that look good and are cool and make us feel like we're still participating members of society.
That's great.
reminds me a little bit of what Laura said about, you know, it's so much about just the negatives. And I think remembering here in the design challenge, we want to, how can we promote the positives, help people do more of what they want to do, more of the fun stuff, you know, whether it's the chair cheerleading. I think a lot of products we see for older adults are very deficit oriented. And how can we start to turn it around to what's the asset we're trying to maximize as someone gets older? And then we're very lucky to have Kevin here with us today. And Kevin, can you tell us a little bit about your story and kind of why you're here and what you're talking about today?
Sure. Is my mic on? So I'm here as a representative of the Davis Finney Foundation, and I'm actually curious because they're a sponsor. Does everyone here know who Davis Finney is and what his group represents? Clearly you do. So Davis Finney is the epitome of what mobility is and when mobility is stolen from you. He has Parkinson's disease. He's an Olympic bike rider who has now made his mission and his foundation's mission how to deal with life without mobility and to celebrate every day that you can get it back. I am a Parkinson's patient. Before I had the same surgery and lost my hair because of brain surgery, I had a full head of hair. And I never dreamed that I would have ever had this disease of what I thought was for older people. But what was ironic on here is that once it was stolen away, and you had seen me before surgery, and this is what controls my surgery, is a high-tech device where electrodes are placed in your brain, and through stimulation, I now am totally normal and I'm disease-free. If you hit this clicker off, I look like I have a stroke on my left side in there. So it's the epitome of what technology and innovation can be on the high side. Now, vanity and all these other things are so true, and the point on here on, you know, I like to wear 501 jeans. And when I wear 501 jeans and I'm not clicked on or I'm not on my medication, I can't button them. So imagine your kids coming up to you and say, Dad, your fly's down again, right? Well, that's the life that you live, low tech. So there's a version of everything that comes in between all of that. I guess the way I look at it is I'm not as worried about losing mobility or the danger of a fall. I'm more worried at this age of my period of entering into the aging world is I don't want to be robbed of the chance to fall. So I don't want to be told that, you know, don't do this, Kevin, don't ski, don't bike. You know, I don't want to be made irrelevant earlier before my time. And frankly, I think as we all age, today's generation that ages wants to be active. Mm-hmm. So for me, my question, my concerns are, how do I sustain that life for the next 20 years? How do I compress the morbid events so that now that I'm getting a peek of what, you know, aging has already been early in my life, how can I help others get there? So that's my story.
Wow, powerful. So I think we want to take this chance to open up to some questions that you all may have. You know, again, this idea of what can we learn from people? And I think we have a lot of wisdom here. And I think another point that you guys exhibit so nicely is too often we bucket older adults, you know, and we don't segment, we just talk about this age and over. And I don't know any of you in the room who buy products because you're 42 or because, you know, you're 22. You buy a product because you have a need and you buy a product because you want to buy the benefits that that product delivers. And so I think we need to remember that that doesn't change with age. And so this group, you know, there's a lot of diversity up here. And as you think about potential design opportunities, we really need to segment it and focus on a unique need and a unique customer. Any questions for the group? If not, I have one. Okay, Ken has one.
So I want to follow up on your comment about being in your 50s when the personal computer was introduced, because oftentimes when I'll talk to people about aging and technology, they'll talk about the technophobia of older people. And I often wonder whether you feel any different about technology, or is it just a generational thing that for people that didn't experience it when they were younger, they aren't comfortable with it when they're older, but now that you have experienced it, it's just life. So does anybody have any thoughts about, in general, technology use by older people and how it's viewed by the rest of the public?
Well, I think the perception is that what older people want to do is to be able to email their grandchildren. And that's the limit of what they think will be suitable for an activity if you are of that age. And actually, that's true of most of them. That is the entry point where they communicate. So it's the communication problem, and it is a eureka experience for them all when they learn how to Google, and they have a question, and they can find out things that they would not be a part of at all. So they could ask it questions. So yes, it's a great handicap not to have been a part of your life until you're in the older ages. And they have, my generation also was at the stage where they were alarmed for the young people going into it and keeping them off Facebook and just really frightened about the effect that it would have on the younger people there. And to try and convince older people to keep their, to be on Facebook or try it, or LinkedIn for any reason, is very, very uphill battle. But the entry level is, I want to talk and I want to see pictures. I want to be in touch.
There's also the importance of habit. We ignore that quite often. You know, older people have learned habits over 30, 40 years, whatever they are. I was watching people coming in at the beginning here, and more or less, I'm generalizing a little bit, the older people were walking in with a piece of paper for their admission, and the younger people were flashing their phones. And that's a habit issue, yeah. And it has to be changed, and it's not easy to change habits. You have to be very motivated to change some established habits of that sort. It'll be interesting to see how older people use the new Apple credit card, so to speak, you know, how long it will take them to make that transition. Younger people will do it right away. And so there is that to be changed. Habit is very powerful.
And I think both of those two comments in conjunction are really interesting, right? What's the motivation? What's the entry point? And then how do you create new habits? Mm-hmm. And I think that's a lot of what we need to be thinking about, especially on the physical activity part of this challenge. Is there another comment?
Students are learning now, and people who work for companies are sent back to school all the time to learn the new technologies and things like that. And we were not brought up in that generation, but you're talking about emailing your grandchildren, and then your grandchildren say, I don't read emails anymore. If you want to get in touch with me, you better text me or Twitter me. So you have to keep evolving, you know, as they are. And I think, you know, they are very much more used to it, and there's a gap there with us, you know, but we've got to catch up or stay up.
Well, I would say it's also an issue of relevance, because when you think about your designs, it should be easy to use, right? And you know, you've seen, I've grown up with computer technology, and I was a software product manager at one point, and everything, we always said, it's easy to use, right? And we know it's almost never easy to use. And so when you think about your designs, you really have to consider how can someone who's older get the benefit of that product without having to, you know, use multiple menus, and if it's too small, I mean the iWatch and so on, I don't really know, but it's part of what you have to think about. And also it's a question of feeling relevant. At one point I had a gentleman who was about 70 working for me in an internet company full of kids. And he was respected as the old man, but he the perception was that he just couldn't figure anything out. Okay, and he was actually pretty good. So I think that sometimes people have a hesitancy to try to use new things and try them because they feel like maybe, you know, they won't be able to do it. And there's a sense of embarrassment too. So I think the designs have to include real ease of use, you know, when you create these products.
I think you're highlighting, you know, the point of the use of the word design. You know, this isn't just a solution challenge. This design is really critical here, and design thinking and really understanding the need is critical. And I think so much of the usability challenges that we see is because of poor design. You know, it's not the user, it's the design that's failing the user's needs. And if you guys saw the company who presented here last year at the kickoff, Lyft Labs, and their Spoon, it's actually for people with Parkinson's and essential tremor,
And it helps negate tremors in the hand and helps people eat independently. And but it's such a great example of beautiful design. There's not even an on button. You just pick it up and it does what it's doing to help you. And so I think those are the kind of designs we're looking for, where the technology falls into the background and the design just really takes it to a new place for someone's independence or empowerment. Were you going to say something?
Yeah, you know, I'm an early innovator, and I was one of the first people in my company to go to the iPhone from a BlackBerry, which should now be in a tech museum. But I started noticing as I was, and I'm an abuser of texting. You know, I text all my colleagues early on. I text my kids and all. And then what I found out was that after a while with Parkinson's, I couldn't text anymore. So thank God for voice recognition and Siri, because now I can voice dictate just as fast as my kids can text back, maybe even faster. So I think that it's not only innovation, but it's all, you know, it's thinking about innovation. It's how do you get people to adopt it, and giving the user manuals for a different generation that may not have the same dexterity. Because these innovations should not be, you know, this is for young, this is for old. It's how do we get them to use it? And I think that's a really big part of it, of adoption.
Ageless design. And right. One of the things we say a lot is, if you only test it with 22-year-olds, you're never going to know if it works for 82-year-olds. But if it works for 82-year-olds, it's probably going to work for the 22-year-olds as well. So I think we just got to flip it on its head and involve older adults and end users in the design process. And so that's why we're really trying to focus on the human-centered design approach.
I just want to say I really appreciate the comment to focus on your assets versus on the deficits. And if you look at senior product advertising all over, it shows seniors as these disabled people. And I know that if I was a senior, I would not like that. And the comment too about disappearing from ads and from the public eye, that's something I never thought of. And I have to say, this is the most wonderfully vital panel of seniors I've seen. And I'm so grateful to hear from all of you. Thank you so much. I have a 72-year-old father who, with my mom, has 24,000 followers on social media. And they did that in a year. I'm curious to know, when you think about socializing, I know that there was an emphasis more on in-person socializing, which totally makes sense. But would there be anything that you all could think of that would be more motivating to be on social media beyond sharing pictures of family and friends on Facebook? Is there anything that you think might actually be really cool that's not out there yet for social media or socializing?
Well, I would say it would be important to learn to use a smartphone, because if you cannot set up dates and times and communicate easily, you get dropped from people's loops. It's too much trouble to try to light up the meetings or to include you in a session when you don't know if everybody will arrive on time at a particular restaurant across town. And so you just exclude them. So I would push myself and everybody else. I have a smart enough phone, but it's not smart enough there.
I think, is your question a little bit about, I know one of the things we've talked about is how do you kind of continue to replenish your social circle? And, you know, we all go to college, you meet a bunch of new friends when you're in your freshman year of college, you have a baby, you meet a bunch of other, you know, families. Like, do you feel that in later life there's these, how can we help people make new friends in later life, and could social media perhaps bring new people into our lives?
Particularly those who don't have their family living nearby.
Mm-hmm. Do you guys know of any ways? I mean, you joined Avanitas, right?
Mm-hmm.
Has anybody used technology to meet new people, perhaps in the Parkinson's community?
Look,
right?
I joined Aging 2.0.
Yeah. And now we're friends.
Yeah, I meet all these people.
Yes. Oh. So it is about putting yourself out there. And how did you find out about Aging 2.0? Through Avanitas, right?
Well, somebody emailed me about it. It sounded like an interesting meeting. And so I was here on your first kickoff,
I
you see. And so if you have interests, then you have to figure out how will I get there and how will I do it.
Mm-hmm. Did you want to say about connecting with other people in the Parkinson's community?
Yeah, I mean, I've created a lot of my own mini groups, you know, and you know, one example is I'm a very irreverent guy, so I apologize for the irreverence on here because I want to fight getting, you know, aging in a negative way, and I think it's good for the mind. But so I created a club called the Friends of Kevin Ski Club, otherwise known as the FOKN Ski Club, right? We'll figure out how to pronounce that. But it started off with 10 individuals, 10 friends. It was a company event. I invited friends to go skiing, and it's grown to maybe 50, 60 different people. And we just text each other amongst our own sort of network in there. So I guess for me, we can create our own networks. You know, it doesn't have to be someone else creating it for you. The tools are there to create our own. It's just a matter of taking advantage of all of those in there.
I like your point, though, about irreverence. I think sometimes we do all this stuff in the senior space, and we make it all so, like, paternalistic, and here you go for this sweet little thing. And you know, maybe it needs to be some effing transportation group that gets themselves around Palo Alto. You know, I think to not put the baby gloves on and really talk to real users about what they need and how they want to be talked to and how we can position products that will actually be things that people want.
It's what Frank talked about, being relevant and still maintaining relevance as we mature, not age.
No, it's a good question. I don't have an answer to it, but I think if you can develop an application that is easy to use and can allow people to create these networks. I mean, something like meetups, sites like that, where you can create your own groups and they can populate and so on. And so, in some sense, I guess, my daughter is 17 and she says the teenagers are no longer into Facebook. So it's kind of like Facebook is becoming Facebook for seniors now. So it's.
Well, we probably have time for like one more question. How about right here?
Yeah.
We've been talking about things and gadgets and software, and I'd like to expand this to a much greater plane. Early on, there was a discussion about how people need to accommodate to their environments, the greater environments. And in the 50s, when we had this triangle picture, and lots of kids and cars and post-war, We redesigned our communities to have big highways and cul-de-sacs and communities that didn't have sidewalks and zoning that had retail all in one place. I'd like to hear what your ideas might be on addressing redesigning our cities.
Do you have some thoughts?
Well, I'm not so ambitious to think of redesigning our cities, but one story I read, and I think it's being repeated in a lot of places, but this one happened in the Beacon Hill community of Boston, where the people on one street, on one long street, decided to make themselves into a village. So they are all now part of a little village, of a community. And I find that idea, that whole way of going, extremely appealing because there is physical proximity. It's very easy to see the neighbors all the time. You don't have to depend on a son or daughter who lives 30 miles away if there is an emergency. So I find that direction, wherever we are, whether we're in the suburbs or in the center of a big city, it shouldn't be too hard to start the little village, mm-hmm. wherever we are.
In the village, if people are interested, there's now a village-to-village network, and these are being set up all around the country. And I know Chris Kennedy's here. This whole age-friendly cities movement is something that's going on in a number of cities, and they talk about our seven or eight different pillars of eight pillars of like what makes an age-friendly community. So there is some stuff happening, and Chris is organizing an event later this month, a week from today. And I'm speaking at it. And of course my slides are done. But thinking about age-friendly Silicon Valley. And so there are initiatives thinking about how do we reshape cities. And it's great to point out that we've done it before. We can do it again. We have new dynamics that we're working with. So Ken said we have a couple more minutes to take a couple more questions.
We have one back here.
Okay. Davis Park.
Hi, Katie. I'd like to start off by just thanking all of you for being a part of this process. I think all too often, which is the whole point of having you up there, We don't really hear from you and get your feedback and input, so I really appreciate your being a part of it. We're in this really exciting moment in this convergence of technology and this really terrific explosion of folks who are really needing like new solutions to aging. But a really key part of this huge transformation in technology and innovation is in a collection of data. And you know, everything from where you go and where you eat and you know, how many times you go to the bathroom every night, and you know, all this data is also what's enabling people to innovate and come up with these brand new solutions and approaches to solving problems. And so my question was like, how do you feel about the collection of all this personal information, and does it worry you, does it concern you, and at what point does it feel like you're giving so much of yourself away that you're really not yourself any longer?
Anybody have any thoughts about data collection? Anybody go, Kevin?
Oh, I think there's initially a phobia, and then if you embrace it, you get over that phobia. You know, I'm on a clinical trial now with my neurotransmitter that it's called the brain radio. So not only does it give me therapeutic benefit, once a month I go into Stanford Hospital and they download a month load of brain data, brain radio and brain mapping. It's part of the initiative of the Obama brain initiative to try to brain map. Now, initially my kids thought that was really kind of exposing too much, and they said, "Dad, your perverse thoughts are now being shown to Congress, right?" But again, I think it's every individual has to find their own time and place, you know, to be able to contribute to something. But again, 23andMe is another great example of giving genetic information. And so I think we are in a world where data is eventually going to come out, and we can either fight it or we can embrace it. And so I guess I've chosen in my world to do it now instead of later, and everyone will have to find their own time for that, right? But I think we can benefit more if we do it sooner than later. It's to your point, it's a great time to have disease. It's a great time to get old.
Well, I don't think it's been, in some sense, I don't think it's that different. I mean, if you go before all the data collection, I would say that most of us didn't have that much privacy anyway. I mean, you can go down to the city hall and find out who's on the deed of your house. At one point, I was working with a company that did claims investigation, and these investigators could find out all kinds of stuff on people without all of the massive data mining. So. I view it as a service, really. I think as long as the data that's being mined can come back and be used by me or by all of you in some productive way, it doesn't really bother me. You learn to ignore all the custom ads coming at you all the time, but I don't feel that it's a problem, as long as it's not abused and provides constructive information.
Do you three agree with what Frank's saying?
Yes. Yeah. There has to be something that I'm getting out of it.
Right, so you know,
it can't be constantly I give the data, I tell them about me, you know, but at some point, and one of the things that's not exploited enough is people, I've seen this in many people who say, "Oh, I didn't know other people had this problem." And just that, you know, being able to say, "Oh, you have the following problem. Do you know that 150,000 other people suffer from the same thing or have questioned us about that?" Just knowing that is already quite a bit of return on whatever data I'm providing. But there has to be something I get in return soon, not later.
You just gave me an idea about, you know, data, and you were talking about social networks, and we're talking about how can we get people more active and connecting more socially. Well, what if we had a bunch of older adults wearing Fitbits and we could suddenly tell you, did you know you walk the same pace as this person? Mm-hmm. And this walking group could form around the 12-minute mile versus the 14-minute mile, because a lot of people might not want to go to a walking group if they're afraid they're going to be the slowest person. So, you know, how can we kind of start to tie these different ideas together that adds social, it adds data that gives her a benefit she wants that's really meaningful in small data in the moment?
I think there's this thing called an ethics check. Right. So I think as long as we are applying ethics, you know, to the innovation and data, then I think it's the same idea that you said. People have always had it. Maybe we had ethics governing it, but to me, that's where it's okay to do that.
Like Google, do no evil. Well, on that note, we will do no evil, and we will hope that the designers in the room today and the ones who are hopefully later watching this video all around the world and understanding the kickoff of this challenge will, you know, be inspired to think about new ways to apply technology to help people stay, enable personal mobility. And with that, Ken, have any closing thoughts?
I'd just like to thank the panel to start with.
Thank you.